So we have to have the fire. To Nachiketa, it revealed in a certain way. But aren't we all Nachiketas? To us, it may reveal in many more ways. Why only 6 chapters? There may be countless chapters in the book of the infinite, and they will be revealed to us. So each of us, ultimately the purpose of this, all these great works are that whatever we end up speaking or writing becomes an Upanishad in its own right, though it's not with the idea that I am writing an Upanishad. None of them bothered even to put their name at the end of it. But our natural speech must become an Upanishad. Kabir says very beautifully, somebody asked him about Vedas. So he says, Jo bolun so Ved kahava, jahan pag dharun so tirath. So whatever I speak is a Veda. Where I step is a tirath, is a holy place. Why? Because I am all the time remembering the divine offering. So that is the state in which the Upanishad bids us to rise, but starts from there. So mind must be lit with this fire, which means for a long time we must withdraw from this externalizing activity. Too much preoccupation of the mind with newspaper and tabloids and WhatsApp and television and computer. I mean, good things are fine, but that's what it means, that if it gives a whole hierarchy, it gives the image of the ratha, that there is human being is like a chariot. So it's also there in the Gita, but the image originally comes in the Katha Upanishad. We take it that it was composed probably a little before Gita, but all these are not what I want to get into, the historical, when it started, whether it was post-Buddhist, pre-Buddhist, let the scholars debate about it. So what is it about the Rath? The Rath image is that the human soul is seated within the Rath. Rath is the body and the senses are the steed. And objects are the path towards they are going. Now, it's very interesting. Now, what is the path? People often ask, okay, which path? Karma yoga, jnana yoga, bhakti yoga, this yoga. And now you have many kinds of yoga, including hot yoga, which recently got disbanded. Hot yoga, yes. Not hot yoga. Hot yoga, because the man is in prison. Steam, yeah. Not hot yoga as Bengali hot yoga, no. It is hot yoga. So steam and all this. So many kinds of. Now, and people speak about path. What is the path? I have not seen a more beautiful description of the path as in the Katha Upanishad. The objects are the paths the senses follow. Meaning thereby, whatever object the mind and the life and the senses dwell upon, that is the path. So beautiful it is. So simple. The journey will bring those consequences. The entire karma doctrine is embedded within this half a phrase. That whatever object our senses are following. Mark the word senses. Are following objects. Now they may be following very worldly objects. Eyeing on the share market. Then that is the path. It's a path, doesn't matter, it'll lead you to wherever share markets will lead you. Or if the senses are following the divine, what is this state where the senses seek for the divine? You see how we have stories of Meera, Surda, they are seeking, I can't see you, I want to see you, my hearing, these senses, they must seek the eternal. And then he says that he cannot be seen and sensed by these gross senses. So he comes and says, he liberates him from that. He says, but he can be, that can be understood by or experienced by the subtle. It's a very subtle thing and give many beautiful images. He says, for example, that when you take up seed analogies elsewhere, but something similar, that when you cut it off, then at the end, what is there? Nothing. There it is. So it is the subtlest of the subtle. It doesn't mean there it is nothing. It, that it exceeds the senses, but the senses must seek. So the senses, the path. Then what is the rain? Mind. So much importance to mind, but mind has only one work. Mind cannot arrive at the highest. This is one of the greatest illusion that all the academia in the world are following. And that's why it's all trash. I mean, this not academics. Sakar is wonderful. But academia in the outside world, isn't it? They are writing papers and all this, and just they think that by the power of the mind, Sakar is born out of a soul cry. So it's something special. And there are such institutes, I'm sure, like that, few and far between. But typical academia, with the mind tries to catch the eternal, it cannot. It will either finish, it will either sleep in that susupti, or it will return more confused than it was before. So, mind, but mind has a role to play. What is the role? Tell the senses which path you have to go. So when the senses are driven towards the objects which will lead to transient gains, the mind must tell the senses, no, this is not what you are here for. You are here for something else. Think about something deeper. And it has nothing to do with closing the eyes. You know, in Sri Aurobindo once, somebody, sadhak, who was meditating for a long time, and people told him he must be a great sadhak. He sits and meditates for such a long time. And Sri Aurobindo's reply, with his characteristic touch of humor, yes, but on his wife. He could see through it. He sits with eyes closed, but he is meditating on his wife. So what will happen? You will realize your wife or husband or son or whatever, because the senses are not under the governance of the mind. So the first step, it gives, as I said, it's a whole method. First step, mother speaks of, use the reason to control the senses. Fundamental step. If the senses are going haywire, all kinds of, you know, we are driven into that, then there cannot be any higher seeking. But controlling the senses is not enough, because there is something beyond the mind, the buddhi. When you control, what happens now? Does it mean we stop seeing, we stop hearing? Now we apply something greater, the greater intellect. So mind is like the, what is it called in English? Lagam. Reins. Lagam. I'm remembering the Hindi word. Reins. Huh? Horses. Reins. But who is the one who is holding the reins? Buddhi. So this is the first step. Sri Aurobindo, in synthesis, after all the treatises, says first fundamental step is purification of buddhi. Disengaging the buddhi from the rest. The Gita speaks of the buddhi yogam as the first step. What does the buddhi has to do? Instead of downward and outward, turn it upward and inward. Bahu shakha nam and vyavsayitmak. That's how the Gita puts it. Vyavasaya, your whole being is concentrated, the buddhi. Otherwise, bahu shakha nam. So morning it is Upanishad. Then after 1 hour it is food. And after another hour it is friends. After another hour it's movie. And you know, it goes on. Bahu shakha nam. So what happens? You get at the end nothing. This, you know, duvidha mein dono gaye, maya mili na ram. So the first step is buddhi. So buddhi is higher than the mind. Buddhi must tell the mind. How will the mind know that what is the real object? And it must, through the mind, pull the reins and give it the right direction. So this is the first fundamental step, that we are on track. How to get onto the path of yoga? First step is that. Then the next is, there is something greater than the buddhi. Buddhi thinks, well, I can by this arrive at the highest. No, it has to further fall quiet. You know, it's a progressive quietening. Through this process, the mind, the vital, the senses become more and more quiet. Otherwise, they are all the time jumping and running from here to there. So beyond the buddhi is the great self. Now, when the buddhi also becomes quiet, turns upward, turns inward with the seeking, with the Nachiketa fire, then there is the great self reflected in the mind as in a mirror, because it's unseen. Sri Aurobindo uses the word, line in Savitri, then the unmanifest is the next step, reflects in the mind as in a still glass. So because otherwise also it is there, but you know, we can't catch it. All the time, there is only one truth that comes at the end. There is nothing else. But because the mind is so restless, it is scattered and we cannot see that. Mother says it so beautifully at one place, that there are many windows in us which open to the infinite. There are so many gaps, so many moments in a day when it opens to the infinite, but we don't take advantage. Let's say we go out and we look at a flower and we say, ah, how beautiful. Now you see, it's a window opening. Now from that we can go into the all beautiful, the all blissful. But we don't take advantage of it. A good deed, a generous deed, something beautiful. Ah, so nice. That child gave something. Now we are stuck with the child. And then next is, oh, what a lovely child. No, what a generous act. Look at the act. And then we will end up into the all generous, the one who is the giver of all things. So this is how the buddhi must become silent, quiet, turned toward the great self. So is there something beyond the great self? It says the unmanifest. Something which is not yet. Now this is a great division which has been there in Indian yogic experience, not thought. So there is the manifest. So manifest world is not only this which we experience, but many other levels which we do not yet experience, and they are hidden behind the various lokas. So these are the manifest worlds. They are already something of the divine is expressed, however distorted, however limited, but it's manifested. Is there something beyond it? Now an evolutionary thought will say, yes, there is more to come. And a static thought will say, no, man is the final. So I have never understood one thing, that though unmanifest is there in Indian thought, how is it that Indian philosophers and thinkers who have read the Vedas and Upanishad never conceived that there can be something more than man? But leave aside the biological and evolutionary, evolution would tell us there has to be something greater. But even this, that there is an unmanifest. Now, unmanifest means something which is not manifested, something new. Of course, Shubindo very interestingly puts it into, if we see Shubindo's plan since we are at it, he speaks of temporal manifestation and he speaks of eternal manifestation. They're the great worlds. But there is something which is not manifest. So in traditional yoga, what they used to do is, Katha Upanishad is not speaking of that, and that's why I love this, you know, as I say, it's a very complete system. From the manifest, you go into the unmanifest. So what happens to your nature? Leave it, let it. All kinds of things will pass through it. The Paramahansa Avastha. You may be like a madman, you may be like a ghoul, it doesn't matter. Because you have entered the unmanifest. And you can dissolve into the unmanifest. Unmanifest, by its nature, you have no bearings, no orientation there. So there is the unmanifest. But Katha Upanishad says, unmanifest is not the last term. That is the beauty. What is beyond the unmanifest? Sa Purusha Evascha. That, the Purusha, the great being. May use the word Sachidanand if you like. He is there. That is there. We may, even she is there, because it says Aditi. It doesn't matter, he or she or it. So there is this absolute which is beyond the manifest and beyond the unmanifest, and the Gita speaks about it. He says, how will you arrive at truth? He says, when you know me as that which is manifest and that which is unmanifest. Vyaktyoham, avyaktyoham. I am both. So there is a great I which is beyond both, which expresses itself through manifestation, holds itself back in the unmanifest form, but is beyond the manifestation and the unmanifest. And that's why he says, that where the sun shines not. What can we speak about him? How can you speak about that glory? The lightning sees, the electrical energy of the mental and the higher mental regions that vanishes. The sun is like a darkness. It cannot shine there. And what to speak of the moon and the stars? All this about the various kinds of illuminations that human beings can have. The moon and the stars are basically the illuminations in the mind, the spiritual mind. So all of this vanishes in that. That is the great origin. And then he tells Nachiketa, this is that thou seekest. Repeatedly it will say, this is that thou seekest. And the beauty of this is that it tells us the goal of life. See, it starts with katha, distress. What is the distress? It's because we don't know the oneself. And what is that oneself? Is it there in some high heaven? The Katha Upanishad tells us it is everywhere. It returns back into creation and says, The Ashwath tree, it gives the image. Again, we see in the Gita a lot of interesting images from the Katha Upanishad are in the Gita and also in some other Upanishad like Nayamatma, Baline. All these images come in with Ashwatthara and other Upanishads. So what is this Ashwath tree? Now it reverses. It says out of that creation has emerged. And what you see here are the branches and the fruits and the trees. Roots are at top. So if you want to really understand creation, go to its roots. Otherwise you can't make sense of life. And so interesting that too, if we don't know the source and origin, we are leading half an existence. Several suggestions come in that. That's why we see in many of these stories, mythological, they start with, you know, what was there before creation. Savitri itself starts with that. It was the hour before the gods awake, the huge foreboding across the path of the divine event, the huge foreboding mind of night, alone, in a unlit temple of eternity. So a very pragmatic person will say, okay, this is, you know, I want to know my problem. What's your problem, sir? I have everyday quarrel with my husband or wife. How do I sort it out? He says, that's what it is trying to sort out. What do you mean? Why should I know about the creation and the source? Because when you discover you are that, then you will also discover she is also that. Then your quarrel will cease. Otherwise, you will arrive at a mutual adjustment, accommodation, temporary harmony, quarrels followed by peaceful. Because it cannot. By its nature, it cannot. And egoistic consciousness will end up like Vajrasrava, getting angry. You can't help it. That's the nature of the consciousness. So all this mental idealism, sentimental and emotional colors of fancy which we weave around magical names. Love is the greatest magic. But it's not born without discovering the one. Because love by its nature leads towards oneness. And unless we know the one, we cannot really experience love. It's a paradox in the highest sense. But when you discover the one, then whole creation you love. Because whole creation has its roots there and it spreads into the cosmos. And then he says, not only in cosmos, now he's reversing the whole thing. He says, even in you, that is there. So close to me, within me, I don't have to go elsewhere. Yes, my child, Nachiketa, you deserve to know this. And I'll tell you where he is seated. That also, what a profound Upanishad this is. He says, in the center of your heart, it is there. And how big is it? A being no bigger than the thumb of man. Angushta Matra Purusha. How beautifully Shobindra in Savitri describes it. But since she knows, she is the Aditi beyond the manifest and the unmanifest. But since she knows the toil of mind and body and life, as a mother knows and shares her children's lives, she puts forth a small portion of herself. See, the same thing. In the Katha Upanishad, he said that, and that is also here. She puts forth a small portion of herself into a hidden region of the heart, a being no bigger than the thumb of man, to face the pang and to forget the bliss. So where do we have to find? One process is by constantly stilling all the parts. This one way. The senses, the objects, the senses, greater than senses are the objects. Make the objects right. Greater than the objects is the mind. Greater than the mind is the buddhi. Greater than the buddhi is the self. Greater than the self is the unmanifest. And greater than the unmanifest is that. This is one path. But then now he is inclined to reveal to Nachiketa another path. He says, go into your heart. You'll find there, subtlest of the subtle, seated within. It is there. It's something you can see. You can become one with. You can experience it. It's forever pure. And it's no bigger than the thumb of man. Now, death also goes on describing very technically. And it says, how is it bound to the body? It has deliberately tied itself to nature. How is it tied to nature? It is tied by 101 cords. It's very, you know, so sometimes I feel it's a very medical Upanishad also. You know, katha, distress, death, we all face. Of course, if a patient comes to me and says, I have fever, I can't tell him, read the Katha Upanishad. But I can definitely tell him that, look, I understand your distress, take the medicine, but know that you are not just the body, but much more than that. Go deep into your heart. Discover that light, that truth, that effulgence, that radiance, that purity, that power, that strength, which is there within you. Go to the doctor, but have faith in that which you are carrying inside. So this is where it says, seek him there. It's there within the heart. So beautifully we see the same thought when Sri Aurobindo in the poem Rishi, written along similar lines. You know, if you want to read, Savitri goes much beyond it. But if one wants to read the Katha Upanishad as in Sri Aurobindo's writings, one of the poems is Rishi. So Rishi tells the same thing. There are many worlds beyond, beyond, beyond. And at the end he gives it. Then he says, that has become all these things. At the end he says, seek him on earth. Seek him in yourself. Because, O King, thou art that. Only the night is on thy soul. So what a marvelous truth he reveals, that you are that. Only it is hidden inside. There is the veil of ignorance. How to tear away the veil of ignorance? Nachiketa, whoever lights your fire, his veil of ignorance will be torn. Whoever recites this at the time of death, this used to be one of the, you know, this Garud Puran, they are one of those which used to be recited during Shraddha. Now, it makes great sense, because imagine that that soul is hovering around. Now, we are very fortunate, you know, this august company of seekers doesn't need anything. But let's say in normal life, there is a person who never had any contact with Katha Upanishad or any Upanishad for that matter. And the poor soul tied up in all the trappings of the vital and mental is still stuck. Oh, my family, my this, my that. And when you read the Katha Upanishad, what will happen? It will say, fool, where am I stuck? So it will disengage. That is how the Bhagavat also, 7 days, when Parikshit hears the Bhagavat, not only he is freed, this is the side story, that there is a demon who is residing in the bamboo tree. That fellow is by default listening and he gets freed. So I suppose, you know, the reason why it was, it is said in the Katha Upanishad that you should recite it during Shraddha, is because it has the power to dissolve all the formations. And I feel that there is this power in this Upanishad, that if we read through it, even hastily, it has the power to dissolve all these formations in which we are caught up. Just reading it is, so what he is saying is that this is not just an intellectual statement of knowledge, it is also a power. Not all scriptures are like that, not all writings are like that. But here there is a declaration that I have put the power in it, that the mere reading, mere recitation of this Upanishad can free us from the bonds of death. So death is giving away his secret. That you want to be free from me? Now I am telling you there are 3 ways to be free from me. First is discover this individual center of divinity. This is the first immortality. When we discover that, we know that death is nothing but a changing of our robes. We don't need to read it. We know it. What happened when the body died? The car broke down. Maybe a bad accident. It's gone beyond repair. But the master has already paid our price and the second car is already ready. That's how Sri Aurobindo puts it. That, you know, we should not worry about it because already another car has been made ready. What we have to do? He will make us quiet little while, give us nice food, then give us the new car. Complete organ transplant, free of cost. New place, new experience. Now drive. Warranty, sir, 80, 85 year old warranty. What if I abuse the car? Then it's a different matter, sir. You know, insurance company also tells you, if you drive rashly, don't blame us. But if we drive it correctly, and the correct driving of the car is described in the Katha Upanishad, then it will serve its purpose. After that it breaks down, you have another. So this is the first immortality, to discover the secret soul within and light up the fire of aspiration. The second immortality is the universal consciousness. The vast, the unlimited, the illimitable, not unlimited is a quantitative term, the illimitable cannot die by its nature. So limitation is death. This is the second meaning of death. First is separation of the soul from the body. This is death. This one, this most elementary. The second is anything which is limited, be it a thought, be it a feeling. That's why all day feelings, thoughts, everything changes. It's all subject to death. So death in its largest sense is whatever is limited, it has a tendency to break the barriers. Why is it doing it? Because we can grow wider. Unfortunately, we don't like it because it means stepping out of our comfort zones. So we don't like people who have contrary opinions. Why? Because my opinion. But if you have a person with contrary opinion, what is it? This is also interesting because this is one crude way of breaking the barrier. This is not the best way. A lot of fight, lot of arguments, not worth it. But still, there is a way. It is trying to break the limitations. And ultimately, illimitable. Because the vaster we become, the closer we are to immortality. That's why the Vedic Rishis use the word Satyam, truth, which is eternal, Ritam. It has its own law of becoming. In creation, there is a law of truth. And there is a distortion of that law by falsehood. That's unrhythm. That's why there is confusion and chaos. Nothing has to go out of manifestation. Thing has to be put in the right place. That is what Rith does. And the third is Vrahatam, vastness. So when we become vast mentally, when our efforts become vast, when our feelings become vast, they are not cloistered into me and mine. But it loves even the body of God in all things. So when we love all beings and all things, then where is the this and that? The barriers break down. The heart becomes vast. Similarly, the life impulsions, when it seeks something vast, not the small transient things. Nachiketa seeks something vast, not more in number, but that state of consciousness where life becomes luminous and free. Then we have again the cosmic consciousness, cosmic vital. And then finally, even the physical, it doesn't touch upon that. That has been left for Mother and Sri Aurobindo, the final touch, because that is the most difficult and nuttiest part. So this is the second immortality. And the third immortality is beyond the individual, beyond the cosmic, is the transcendent. To get into that, which has neither any beginning nor an end. Because the cosmos has a beginning, at least according to the Katha Upanishad. This is the beginning. That's how it speaks of. Of course, in a certain sense, we can say there is no beginning because its roots are in the eternal. But we can say that there is a beginning and an end. That's why we talk about the cycles of time and the pralayas. So there is a beginning and an end. But transcendent has no beginning, no end. Obviously, there is no death. So these are the three ways death expounds to Nachiketa, to be freed from its own clutches and discover immortality. Last but not the least, which I find very interesting about this scripture, this is something we have grown up in Indian traditions. So whenever a story was told, we used to have this Savitri puja and this puja and that puja in my house. At the end of every puja and story, it used to be, jaise iska bhala hua, vaisa sabka ho. You know, the way Savitri conquered death, may it happen in everybody's life. So, Katha Upanishad also ends with that whoever hears this doctrine, it will be freed from the clutches of death. So, it is a power embedded in this. With this, we can stop. This is the central elements in this Upanishad. Tomorrow, when we have time, we will probably pick up few interesting slokas, few interesting lines or passages. I don't want to speak the slokas because I don't want a single Sanskrit word to be wrongly pronounced. But we'll pick up passages, the translations, definitely. And we'll pick them up. Now we have the images, we'll connect with it and go through each of the cycle in that way. But any questions, any thoughts, any sharing, most welcome.
Sir?
Yes, please. Yes. Yes.
Does it imply that there is a constant number of atmas in the universe? Or
yeah.
Does it imply?
Yeah. So it's also there in this. It's uncreated, unborn. But it implies not quantitatively. That's what I said, that in many of these terms, There is a quantitative understanding, there is a qualitative understanding. So qualitatively, Atma is neither created nor destroyed. Quantitatively, because the one is infinite, there can be any number of Atmas in terms of number. Because to limit the number of souls is to limit the infinite. So new souls will keep entering into the existence, and new souls will, and some will opt for this or that. When probably Earth is filled, we will have creation on Venus, Mars, Pluto, Neptune, God knows where. After all, there is a lot of space which is uninhabited. We should think about those places also. So, but there is a very interesting story about it. When mother went back, though she has not said that this happened with me, but I'm sure the way she has described, intuitively I do believe it's mother's own story. But it's not narrated like that. So she says when somebody went back from India, and some of those who knew the person, who used to meet, they met and said, oh, you have come from India, the land of souls. So do they count souls? Do they count souls? How many are there? How many? So she says that the person held out one finger and said one. That's the beauty of the Atman realization. There's many, at the same time it's one. So what happens when we realize the psychic being? Now there is subtle differences between psychic being, the psychic essence, and the inmost soul, the Jivatma. I'm not entering into that. That's not directly the theme of cut, but we can take it up if there is a question. It does speak about the Jiva and other things. But the moment one realizes the psychic and identifies with it, what is the experience like? Among many other things, one of them is that this is one mode of expression of the eternal. But so is this, so is that, so is this, so is that, so is everything. So there is one which is distinctive. There is a distinctiveness with the psychic. But there is also the sense of unity with the psychic. That's why Yama tells him to enter through this door. Because the moment you touch the psychic, it's very easy to universalize. But if you try to do it just with the mind, life and body, especially without the lighting the fire, you enter into the cosmic ignorance, which is a dangerous thing. So there are yogis who with forceful practices like breathe, 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 and eventually you can have an experience of entry into the cosmic consciousness, but it's very dangerous because you lose your bearings. There's nothing to really orient you or hold together. So that's why the barrier of the ego is there. There is a reason why ego has been created. Otherwise, it'll be like unfiltered. You won't know where you are, who you are, then you'll just wandering around, it doesn't matter. It's a very, you know, then there'll be no difference between the mystic and the madman. But the mystic can orient himself because he knows that this is it, which is the one mode of manifestation of the internal. So psychic is all the time conscious of the divine presence behind it. So this fire is also the fire which holds the psychic. The fire is always the divine will which is operating, which is on the height, which is within matter, the sun, that's how it is described, which is in the countless moon and stars, the mental worlds and other worlds. But it holds the psychic within it, like the story of Prahlad with, you know, in the fire. So that's the beauty, this divine will. The moment one becomes conscious of the psychic, one becomes aware of the divine will within oneself. But one also knows that this divine will is not limited to this being. It is expresses itself in everyone. So there is differentiation and there is unity. They go together. So there is, we can say there is only one soul. We can say there are many souls. And there can be, theoretically, infinite numbers, if we can use this paradox. Yeah.
You mentioned something about the 101 powers. So what are they? Can you elaborate?
I wish, you know, this anatomy was taught to me. They didn't. But yes. The chords which are described, I can tell you what they mean. Because what I am saying is that in anatomy we are described great detail, every nerve. So the watershed between the subtle body and the gross physical is the nervous system. That's why you'll see that nervous system is extremely sensitive to the touches from outside. And people who develop at a certain stage of evolution become extremely sensitive even to thoughts, feelings. Then they have to go past that stage. Many people, you know, can enter into chaos, but you have to go past that state and discover the one great self. And that's why the first boon, peace, is so important, because the journey he's going to undertake can be completely ruffled and, you know, roughed up. So these nerves are in the subtle body. Now they also extend into the physical body, and through the physical body, especially through the heart center. So, you know, you have the sevenfold cords, but ultimately they can be reduced to three main cords, and then many, many branching sub nerves through that. So there is a cord which ties the mind firmly, the nervous system. So this is the nodal center. So you have these subtle nerves, and then it enters into the mental box, not the mental box, but the instrument for receiving the mind, which is the brain. And it ties itself there. It holds a grip. The second is through the heart, which is the central being, and it ties itself through that to the rest of the body. So if you see, even purely anatomically, brain is the seat of consciousness. So it controls, the master controller, but heart is the master energizer. So these two are the most important organ. And third, at the base of the spine, in the muladhar, where, you know, all these in matter itself. So these are the three main cords through which it ties itself. And then there are many subs. So, you know, 101, this is again a very interesting image, which in Vedas, the numbers have their own interesting counterparts. You can multiply with three, but here it's a multiplication with seven, because basically you have the sevenfold cord. So seven, you multiply with seven, becomes 49, and you multiply with two. Shubhendu, in one of the places, talks about the ascending and the descending current. So nerves which go up and the nerves which go down, and you have the one at the base and the one above. So it becomes 100, and the one that jiva, which is inside, not just above and below, that becomes 101. So this my own, I just spontaneously I am sharing something, but there could be other ways of looking at it. But all these hold, but these three are the main cords. If these three one can loosen up. So if you loosen the cord of the mind, you become nut loose, and you are in the best condition to enter into the vastness. So people who think they are very wise and very pragmatic are not ready for, you know. So a little bit nut loose is a very helpful thing, you know. That's why you will see many nut loose cases all around here. Because it's important, you know, if the extremely pragmatic person, people come nowadays, you know, to join the ashram, you have to come to the psychiatrist. So they come to me. So that I ask them, so are you normal? This is the only question I ask. So one person gave me a very good answer. Said, sir, if I was normal, why would I be here? I said, that's the answer I've been looking for. Nobody gave that answer. I must fit super fit. With everybody, it's fit. Because everybody gets a bit apprehensive. Are, if you are normal, you would be pursuing normal aims. Why would you come for a yoga of transformation, you know, all this, or any yoga for that matter? Normal aims are what other people pursue. An aim like Nachiketa is an abnormal aim. So in that sense, so a little bit of nut loose. So this is one big notice. The second is heart. That's why many people during the time of death experience pain. And this pain, and I really believe that heart attacks, you know, what we call as, you know, blockage, all this. This is, I don't want to get into this whole theory. It's a very murky thing, motivated with commerce, this knowledge, that knowledge. I'm not convinced, having gone through all the scientific literature, that heart attack actually takes place because of the actual blockages. And there are many people like me who are not convinced about it. And I'm not getting into that. But there are blockages observed, there is heart attack. But heart attack is one time when actually there is what is called in Indian thought as Kal Yoga or Mrit Yoga. There is that great force which tries to pull away, cut the heartstrings. Now, if you have fear, you know, who are the Yamdut? Fear, anxiety, they are the Yamdut. I mean, figuratively, there are actual Yamdut also. They are not that bad. But fear is worse. So they bring, yeah, they are nice guys and they are very scared of us. We tell them from the soul that get lost. We don't belong to you, they'll go away. Sorry, sir. Savitri story, that's how it happened, no? They're very scared of Brahmins, that means seekers. That's why when Yamdut see Nachiketa, they run to their master. Please, sir, somebody has come uninvited, but he has a fire inside. We can't go near him. You go ask him, no, what he has come for. So, well, that's a subtle part of it. But essentially, when the heartstrings are cut, now, you know, it is very occult ramifications. When they are cut, there is the pain. Now, who will not experience the pain? The mother was asked this. She said, who has practiced detachment in life? What does Katha Upanishad say? Katha Upanishad says the same thing, that when you tear the cut open, when the heart strings are cut asunder, then no more doubts. You are a free person. Now, this detachment is not externally throwing away an object or a person. In fact, this detachment is the beginning of a true relationship with life, with people, with creation. Because it means that the egoistic bondage that I had formed between this limited personality and that limited being is gone. Now there is a deeper bonding, the same Yajnavalk story with Maitri, that we love the wife not for the sake of the wife but for the sake of the self. We love the husband, the child, not for the sake of them, for the sake of the self. We love the country, not for the sake of the country, which can be an ignorant sentimental attachment, but for the sake of the self. Now Shubhinda says, as is the self, so is the love. If we are living in ego, then it's for my egoistic self. If it is the greater self, the great self, at least, if not the one, then it is for the sake of the greater self. Then we see the same in everybody. And then we cooperate, we help. We help each other grow towards the truth. That is the original sense of the fire in the center of marriage, and then three and a half, whatever around it. That look, you know, the center is fire, not the ego, not the mother-in-law, not the father-in-law, not my dad, not your dad, not my mom, not my family, not my surname. Center is aspiration. So that's how, you know, so this is the hard part, which if while we practice detachment, then this string becomes loose. We live with everybody, but we are never overwhelmed with any situation or an event. This is the sign. We face situations, but as Shobindu described, they'll come, touch for a while, and then pass away. It's like, you know, on the water, you beat water. For a moment, there is splash. There is a line, and then next moment, it's all ironed out. So that is the state when we practice this detachment. So then the heart strings are cut asunder. But the third end knot is the physical. So again, anatomically, we observe the same sequence in death. First is brain death. Next is the heart stops. And third is cellular death, which takes 6 to 8 hours. Actually, this is the most difficult part. But it again has a ramification. Now, this is not the katha, but the question is relevant. And the cut does give a hint. It started with 101 nerves. That's why you have to allow time after death and the, either the burial or the fire. Because 101 after all, you know, even if all the Yamdutas are working overtime, they'll take, you know, it has been fixed in such a way that we can't figure out where these nerves are. Forget about, you know, undoing them. So even the expert engineers of Yama takes at least 6 to 8 hours. But even after that, the psychic may not decide. It wants to gather that, okay, you have detached me from the body, but there are things inside which I need to carry. This baggage is there. These cells are holding the touch of, oh no, divine mother touched my head. I must carry that consciousness. Oh, my heart, such beautiful feelings were embedded inside the cells. I must carry it. My feet have several times gone to a pilgrim spot. These feet contain something. So it takes a long time to, even after that detachment, which takes normally 6 to 8 hours, the standard mother would suggest 24 hours for the full thing to be extracted. Then the body can be called as, you know, dead body. Yeah, that facilitates the process. This departure is taking place. You have to give it respect. You have to give it its due. Now, we as doctors make a very trenchant distinction between living and dead. But this is not true. Mother says there are many who are living but like dead. There are many who are dead but very alive. So you have to allow, you have to respect this process. Like any other process. Death is not an end of life, it's a process of life. It's like telling, you know, this forcibly doing something is like evicting somebody from the house and saying, now get lost. I put a lock, you can't enter. But that's not a process. That's something forced. Nature doesn't do like that. Nature says, look, you know, I am going to, there is another house for you, you will discover it, but this you have to leave, it's become very tattered. So you say, okay, I'll leave it. You may linger, you may say, roof is leaky, but I am very attached to it. But at some point it says, now look, you know, your time is up, you got to go. So then it says, okay, but I have to pick up this, pick up that. So what do you want to pick up? Transient things? No, you have to leave it. What do you want to pick up? My passport and, you know, ticket and visa? Yeah, that you can carry. So there are things which are eternal moments in any life. And those have to be picked up. They're all embedded in the cells. You know, we don't understand this mystery of the human body. It's not there in this because that's not Katha himself. Human body has many impressions. It retains vital impressions. We all know. That's how habits are formed. You smoke a cigarette and you know you get into habit. It retains mental impressions. Somebody has said something to you. For 100 days you remember this fellow. He said this to me. What is it? The cells. He is not saying anything after that. But you carry the impressions. So the cells retain the memory. How about the psychic and spiritual impressions? That also is embedded in the cells. But that is a much higher thing. This is up till graduation or maybe MA. But PhD and beyond is Mother and Shobindo. Cellular yoga, cellular memories, cellular impressions of the spirit, cellular transformation, all that belongs to another domain. Yeah. So it's there. It's there in the Indian tradition. So without making a rigid rule, what it means is that there is a time lag between your saying goodbye to the house and your actually reaching your destination. I look at it like that. Very simply, you set out on a journey, let's say from Hyderabad to Pondicherry. So you, what happens? You set out of the house and you are in a taxi. And still something within you is, yeah, at home, you are talking about home. And then you have a phone call, so beta, where have you reached? Oh, mom, don't disturb me, I'm still on the way to, you know, airport and then check in. And you are messaging that checked in, security check done. You are still connected. Then what happens? Then the next step is you reach. You take a flight, you have reached Pondicherry. So you've gone to guest house, you're still, something is still connected. Oh, I had my food then. So you're feeling hungry now. So you want to take a food. Oh, can I get something which, you know, I love in Hyderabad? No, sir, you can't get it. You get something else. Then finally, you enter the ashram. Now what happens? Now your phone is turned silent or switched off. And you are face to face with the eternal. So this takes about 10 days, 13 days, 4 days. Some people little longer. Most people within 10, 12 days. But for the great ones, for the realized one, it doesn't matter. They will say like Swami Vivekananda, I have spat my body. Or like Pavitrabuddha, I have taken my body and put it into the Divine Mother. So it depends on, the great ones don't need anything like that. That's why for the great ones in India, you don't burn the body, you give samadhi. The idea is that, you know, they are not attached to the body any which way. So if you have the body around, there is a tendency for it. Now this is a different subject, which is better, which is not, etc., etc. But the point is that the great ones are given a samadhi because their body can continue to retain some of these vibrations and attract some of these vibratory energies. So in a certain sense, it's good to bury, but there are issues within it because in a typical burial place, you have these what are called as elemental energies. When the being fragments. So many desires, greeds, all these are hanging around, which people experience when they go into a typical shamashan. You know, this is very nice. Muthialpet is a lovely place. And of course, you grow up, you don't care. Anyway, it's a nice place. See, it's not bad. Nice, sweet. I'm telling you, it's better than Harishchandra Ghat of Varanasi. I have been to both the places. In Varanasi, Manikarnika Ghat, Harishchandra Ghat, and I've been to Muthialpet. Very honest impression. You don't feel any sting of death here. In Manikarnika, you feel a detachment, you know, virakti from kya hai life. Sometimes you may also feel, some people feel repulsed. But here you will never feel any of those experiences. It's a special place. But otherwise, in a typical place where all this is taking place, so there are a lot of defragmented beings which are thrown out. So what happens by fire? Fire destroys even those. Physical fire can destroy subtle entities, elemental energies which are very close, but are called as bhutas. So it is meant to purify. This mother herself has said. That's why the fire, she says that in India, because the occult knowledge was there, therefore they used fire. That's between the two. Okay, so I think we'll stop here today. We meet tomorrow again. If there are more questions, if we want to take up question answer, we can do that. As I said, cut or beyond any frames. Yeah. Thank you so much.